organizers for the invitation to London to speak at this wonderful conference. I'll be talking about a major theme in the study of black holes over the years, and that is the information problem, or what has been called a paradox. And in a nutshell, this can be summarized as follows. If you throw information into a black hole, it can't get out by locality. It can't be destroyed because that would violate quantum mechanics. And also, it turns out in a very serious way, energy conservation. And it can't be left behind in a remnant because that would lead to catastrophic instabilities. So there's no apparent good answer. We've been stuck with this problem for over 30 years, and one possibility is that we've made a stupid mistake. But as we've sharpened things over these 30 years, it's become increasingly, I think, clear that that is not the case. There's no obvious stupid mistake here. And that instead, this is an indicator of some new physics that we have to understand. In fact, it seems like we should regard this as representing a fundamental conflict between three basic principles of physics: Lorentz invariance, or a more local version, diffeomorphism invariance, quantum mechanics, and locality. And those seem to fit together sort of locally, so to speak, or in a sort of piecewise fashion. But when you try to fit them all together, it seems that we have a conflict. Now, that's a problem because these are the building blocks or cornerstones of our basic framework for describing all of physics so far, local quantum field theory. And it appears that local quantum field theory is a so-called impossible object, referring to Escher's kinds of constructions, in the gravitational context. A couple of other comments. If you ask what needs to be modified, well, quantum mechanics and Lorentz invariance are very hard to modify if you try to respect consistency and basic facts we see through observation. But locality, in the context of gravity, is a softer notion. I should also mention, it seems that this problem is not so much about the short distance issues of the singularities and renormalizability, but in fact seems to be a problem more sort of relevant at very long distances. So we need some new ideas, it seems, and if we search for a historical analog, I think a good one is the instability crisis for the classical atom. Now, there we had a manifest breakdown of the laws of physics when the electron spirals into the charge center. But in the end, the answer was not that we needed to just modify things at, so to speak, r equals zero in a small way. We discovered that quantum mechanics completely takes over from classical mechanics at a much larger radius, the Bohr radius. New physics was needed, and that involved the important principles of quantum mechanics. So the suggestion is, we're in a similar situation, and we see that local quantum field theory breaks down manifestly at r equals zero, but it appears that quantum gravity, or some aspects of it, need to be relevant all the way out to the Schwarzschild radius, and actually there are indications we see a more subtle breakdown of local quantum field theory there. In terms of moving forward, we seem to find that new physics is needed, and the big question is, what is that physics? So taking this viewpoint, that the black hole information paradox is analogous to the classical instability paradox, this paradox or unitarity crisis could well serve as a guide to understanding these new principles and mechanisms, much as the, well, understanding the problem of atomic stability led to the development of quantum mechanics. What other guides do we have beyond those comments? Well, there have been a number of different ways of attacking this set of problems. And here's a list. Let me first mention the ones I won't be talking about. So there's the story of microstates. There's been a fair amount of discussion here. Their relations to inflationary cosmology. I've explored some of the connections, many others have as well. There's the question of locality and gravity and how to get out approximately local observables. For more information on that story, you might consult this reference. There are studies of the gravitational S matrix, which I think furnish important clues. And here's a place to learn more about at least what I've said about that. There's this very interesting story of amplitude magic in supersymmetric Yang-Mills and supergravity, which is very beautiful, although a big question is what happens in the non-perturbative regime, and as we'll see, as I'll mention, we really face a non-perturbative problem. So those are some of the things I'm not going to talk about, which are guides, but I'll focus on briefly a few comments about ADS-CFT, and then the problem of correspondence and ultimately the question of quantum information transfer from black holes. So comments on ADS-CFT. And for more elaboration, you can look at that reference. Many here, I think, and elsewhere, regard ADS-CFT as a resolution of the problem or paradox. But there's a question, and that is how do we recover from the boundary theory, a sufficiently detailed bulk description of evolution on scales small as compared to the ADS radius, for example, formation and evaporation of a black hole, and also a description of observers falling into that black hole, which after all, we could be such observers. How do you get that out of ADS-CFT? You appear to need a map at the full interacting level between the boundary Hilbert space and the bulk Hilbert space that's one-to-one and unitary. Now, that would answer a lot of the questions, or at least help, because we know that evolution on the boundary is unitary, and you could then use that map to construct the bulk evolution operator and study the evolution of states and so on. But how do we find that map? And that's been a big problem. A couple of approaches. One has been to try to find at least approximately local bulk observables. In general, finding local observables is a challenge in quantum gravity. There's been a lot of discussion of this, for example, at the recent KITP workshop we had. And in general, in quantum gravity, it seems that a useful approach is the so-called relational approach, which I've already given you a reference for. But it's not, the upshot of a lot of this discussion is that the final outcome is not really clear. It's not clear how to formulate the appropriate observables in a precise fashion. Although, this set of relational ideas actually is realized and, in fact, used in studying the observables of quantum cosmology. But the question is how to make that sharp in ADS. Another approach to trying to decipher the physics of the bulk is to try to extract the S matrix in the flat space limit. Here, the problem is to construct scattering states from the boundary data and extract the full fine-grained S matrix. And there are some challenges in that, which I don't have time to fully summarize, but I've given at least some discussion here and in with my student, former student Michael Gary, in the reference I gave previously. So it's not clear how ADS-CFT answers this set of questions. And whether or not it does, it seems worth thinking about more general perspective. So on the more general end, three approaches are to investigate this question of correspondence, to think about quantum information transfer. I'll talk about those, and then there's the question of studying the gravitational S matrix, as I've mentioned, which that would be another talk. I'm not going to give that talk today. So first, correspondence. In physics, the notion of correspondence is a very important one. The question of when an existing theory breaks down and what replaces it, and where it gets replaced. In our case, the existing theory that we're working with is local quantum field theory and, say, a semi-classical gravitational background. There have been various proposals for where that breaks down. Planking and curvatures, there are proposals involving modifications to the uncertainty principles, say, motivated by the notion that strings can get excited. There are ideas of modified dispersion relations and, of course, holographic bounds. Let's think about this a little bit more carefully. So first of all, what are the configurations of our existing theory? And the configurations are states, say, Fock-based states. A typical one might be a two-particle state, where the particles are in minimum uncertainty wave packets with approximately definite positions and momenta. And for such a two-particle state, you could ask, well, where don't we trust this kind of Fock-based, simple Fock-based description? And it's pretty clear that that should fail, for example, when the separation between the particles is small as compared to the appropriate power of their center of mass energy. And this we called the locality bound. And it plays a role, I think, analogous to the Heisenberg microscope discussion in quantum mechanics in setting limitations on our existing theory. There it was classical physics, here it's local quantum field theory in a semi-classical background. And there are various multi-particle generalizations I've just illustrated, say, with two-particle states. Another way of phrasing this is that if you think about forming the state behind, well, that I've shaded out here from some state in the past, if you sort of time reverse, certain states could only come from, so to speak, white holes. So you really need to understand gravitational physics. So we seek guides to this regime. And I'm going to assume that quantum mechanics is true and take it seriously. Have to start somewhere. And moreover, I'm going to assume at least a coarse notion of locality, namely that we can break up, say, quantum black hole and its environment into quantum subsystems. And so there's a tensor product structure to the Hilbert space, and that we have information exchange between those two subsystems, and that everything is unitary. From one viewpoint, this is just giving an effective quantum theory description, but really it can be more. And the reason for that is if you think about where field theory comes from. If you start out with an effective quantum description of particles, and you include the principle of locality, and you include Poincaré invariance, then in fact you discover the structure of local quantum field theory, I think, as many of you know. So you can really combine principles and find a fairly tight structure as we know in physics. And the notion is to try to do something like that here. What other guides do we have to how the black hole interacts with its environment? Well, you might ask that the evolution be as close as possible to local quantum field theory. Of course, that's an incomplete model of the quantum subsystems, as I've mentioned. Let's quickly review what local quantum field theory, in fact, says. So here's a picture of a black hole, singularity, horizon, what looks to the infalling observer like vacuum actually gets turned into outgoing Hawking particles and partner excitations going into the singularity by the strong tidal forces. And it's easiest to give a Hilbert space description of this if we choose a slicing. And the slicing that most nicely, or clearly, sharply, illustrates the tension with local quantum field theory is the so-called nice slicing, asymptotically Schwarzschild time slices, but then staying away from the singularity going into the black hole. And here's an explicit parameterization for, a Schwarzschild black hole of such slices. And so we'd like to discuss the state on these slices. And that state is what I'll call the Hawking state. It has the following structure. So we have basically a vacuum for the inside modes and for the outside modes. And then we act on that, those vacua, with these paired creation operators, again, inside and outside modes. This is a squeeze operator, this combination. And another way of writing this full expression is, shows manifestly the correlation between the occupation number states and the thermal factor. So that's an expression for the so-called Hawking state, which can be made very explicit in, say, two-dimensional black holes. And there's one small, oh, actually I should say, these indices, the index J corresponds basically to a discrete version of the asymptotic frequency, and N corresponds to position along the slice. We picked a basis for wave packet sig. Now there's one subtlety with this expression, and that is N, which labels position along the slice, is a, well, sort of a logarithmic coordinate, or a discrete version. As N goes to infinity, you're getting closer and closer to the horizon, and so shorter and shorter wavelength. Now those modes, as I've said, look like they're in vacuum to the infalling observer, and so let's regularize by not using this description for modes smaller than a certain proper wavelength, whatever you want that cutoff to be, let's call it L. So the short wavelength modes we treat differently than the longer wavelength modes because they look like they're in their vacuum. And so I'm going to rewrite this Hawking state in the following form. I'll separate off the, so to speak, short distance modes and just call the state they're in, you know, the vacuum, or zero sub n, and then only write this kind of expression for the longer wavelength modes. And at this point, I have exhibited the state of the black hole as an element of a product Hilbert space. What just happened? Okay, not the best time to do backups. That's bizarre. I've never had that happen before. Okay, so we've exhibited the state as an element of a tensor product Hilbert space. This one-dimensional factor can go either way. You can think of that as doing with the black hole or being ancillary in the sense that we describe it, sort of ancillary Hilbert spaces in quantum information theory. I should also mention that now the Hilbert spaces we're really working with are finite dimensional if we're talking about evolution of the black hole for a finite amount of time. And evolution, for example, in the two-dimensional case is very simple. Say if we're talking about massless matter, the evolution operator is just one, if you work in this kind of basis. More generally, we could evolve on those slices via the unitary, or via the evolution operator of local quantum field theory. We could also include infalling matter and so on. Now again, there's a subtlety involving this cutoff that what's happening is short distance modes get pulled to longer and longer distances. And so if we want to have the cutoff in place for a fixed proper distance or proper wavelength, then we need to, change the value of N we use for the cutoff, capital N, as we go forward in time. And so this corresponds to something like, well, it's a generalized unitary transformation. The dimensions of the factor Hilbert spaces change, but we're always considering one-to-one maps that preserve the inner product. A nice cartoon of this is if you just think about, say, a time step, which is the light crossing time, and you sort of model things as, you know, simple qubits, and you have the vacuum at one time evolve to the vacuum at a later time, and then you either produce a pair of particles or you don't, and here I'm just setting the thermal factors to one. There is, in principle, a thermal factor there. So these are some simple toy models for the story, and also, of course, Mathur has explored such models. Now, this kind of evolution ultimately leads to the unitarity problem. If we think about what we see outside, well, there's a density matrix, which we get by tracing over the interior degrees of freedom. And that has a von Neumann entropy, which grows with time up to the Bekenstein-Hawking size, roughly, at the evaporation time of the black hole. And that represents the missing information that either, that led to the notion of either destruction of information or of remnants, either of which are problematical. So what we'd like to understand is how this information, or the entropy, goes back down, the missing information. In a curve that looks more like this, starting at, say, something like the half-life of the black hole. Well, there are arguments for why local quantum field theory fails to give the right answer on these timescales, which I've given in these references. Long story short, there are problems making the, turning this into a sharp gauge invariant calculation, and there are also problems with perturbative quantization on these slices on these timescales. And while that may resolve a sharp paradox, that simply leaves us a problem of explaining how we get evolution that gives us something like the red curve. How do we get this correct evolution? What framework gives us that? So again, I'm going to think about the story in terms of a product Hilbert space structure. And let me mention that if ABF-CFT does give us a complete description, it could well work this way in terms of quantum subsystems. It quite plausibly does. Let me actually refine a little bit more. If we're thinking about a quantum black hole, I'm going to consider the atmosphere or near states separately from the states that are far away, say off in the next galaxy. And let's talk about our expectations for the structure of these individual factors. So, of course, the Hilbert space far away from the black hole, if we're not doing things like making black holes far away, is basically that of particles streaming through space, approximately given by local quantum field theory. Likewise, really, for the modes in the black hole atmosphere, we would expect, to a good approximation, or we might expect, but obviously we need a big modification of the local quantum field theory description for the black hole Hilbert space. And in fact, we expect that to be finite dimensional, and one guess for its size is given in terms of the Bekenstein-Hawking entropy. Regarding evolution, of particles that, say, move from the near Hilbert space to the far, we expect to be sent to a good approximation described by local quantum field theory. But as I've already explained, local quantum field theory does not give us the correct evolution, apparently, describing interactions of the black hole atmosphere and black hole states. And in particular, the black hole Hilbert space needs to shrink, and the information needs to unitarily transfer into the external states. There are various other constraints on the evolution. So I've said S needs to go to zero. We might ask that the evolution look fairly innocuous to observers falling into a black hole. There are various expectations about the information transfer rate and whether it looks approximately like Hawking's description. Ultimately, in the full story, we need a good correspondence limit with local quantum field theory. There should be energy conservation there. It should be part of a complete consistent framework, et cetera. So there are non-trivial constraints. In fact, it's not clear that this collection of constraints are the essential ones can all be satisfied at all. And so we should think about ways that they could be satisfied. And a basic guideline in all of this, I think, is to try to be as conservative as possible, close as possible, in particular to local quantum field theory. So let's look at examples of evolution, thinking about, say, modeling things in this qubit framework. So there's the picture I've already described. And the question is, how do we modify that picture to get unitary evolution in a conservative fashion? Let me start with what is not the most conservative way of modifying things, I believe, by different measures. For example, we could have a qubit that goes into the black hole, and so it becomes part of the internal state. And then we could act on the internal Hilbert space with some random unitary operator on a fairly short time scale, order r or r log r. And then once we've done that, once we've scrambled things, then we could have, in the new basis, a bit simply transfer into the external state from separating, scrambling, and transfer. And of course, I could give a more general finite dimensional model, but the qubit story is useful for illustrating the basic principles. Why do I say that's not the most conservative kind of evolution? Well, first of all, it's a big departure from local quantum field theory evolution. And the story that gets told related to this is the story of complementarity. And in fact, there's a measure for this. As Hayden and Preskill showed, if this is the kind of evolution we have, then after sufficient evolution, if you throw a bit into a black hole, the information in that bit will reflect back on a timescale of order the scrambling time. So this is a big departure from local quantum field theory. In fact, one way of classifying the different kinds of evolution is in terms of the scrambling and transfer time. And so here we're talking about scrambling and transfer on the relatively short timescales r log r. They're much shorter than the timescales on which we need to transfer information, as I've discussed previously, earlier in the transparency, which is a timescale of order r times s. Of course, the local quantum field theory description never transfers, so that's a big departure from this short timescale. And in fact, never scrambles if you look at the nice slice description. If you took a more natural slicing that goes into the singularity, you might expect that you get some scrambling when the slices do encounter the singularity. So there's a lot of space here between these relatively short timescales and what we need. Another example, which I think is not most conservative, is that of massive remnants, a scenario long ago suggested, and a recent incarnation of that, I believe, which is the fuzzball story. So the picture here is that the black hole evolves to something that involves a lot of states living outside the would-be horizon. So we have big modifications, therefore, to the black hole Hilbert space of local quantum field theory, and a rapidly varying microstructure outside the horizon to encode all of this information. And it's very hard to see how you wouldn't go splat when you hit an object like this, something like hitting the surface of a neutron star. Okay, well, a good question is whether evolution is required to be such a big departure from local quantum field theory. For example, Mathur has shown theorems limiting what kind of evolution one should consider, and my student Shi has generalized those in certain directions. But let me just jump ahead and give you some models which are unitary and, by the measures I've outlined, I think more conservative. So the first model is the following. So we start with something like the nice slice state, the state inside the black hole, and let's isolate two qubits, let's say the leftmost qubits, the ones furthest back in time, and let's transfer them unitarily into the Hawking modes in this fashion. So this is a one-to-one inter-product preserving transformation, and we could also, of course, have some so-called local unitary evolution acting on the outside particles, particles near the black hole evolve to further away and so on. And you could have some unitary evolution inside the black hole. But that's the basic structure of a model of information transfer. And this is something you can turn into more general multi-mode models, not just in these qubit toy models. And this is a kind of evolution that's very Hawking-like. In fact, until time when the, so to speak, internal degrees of freedom become very excited, this is basically just the qubit Hawking evolution. But ultimately, for an old enough black hole, you get some modifications of the Hawking evolution. And in particular, the expectation value of, say, the outgoing energy flux is the same as that of the Hawking flux. So this is a very, in some sense, innocuous modification. A slightly less innocuous modification is to isolate, say, the leftmost qubits and transfer them not into the usual Hawking modes that are excited, but into some other modes, say the modes of wavelength of order of the black hole radius over 10. And so you could unitarily transfer there, but still have the usual Hawking process taking place. Again, up to unitaries acting on the external and internal Hilbert spaces. This can also be generalized in a fairly straightforward way to the full multi-mode models. It's a more generic kind of evolution, and it also yields some extra energy flux. There's an important constraint here. You don't want the energy transfer out to be too fast with respect to the information transfer, or you get stuck again with the problems of information loss or the need for remnants. So again, there are important constraints on such models. So these two models illustrate some basic features, and obviously further complexity is possible and various other constraints can be applied. Let me just make a couple of comments. So first of all, these models do not involve local evolution with respect to the semi-classical geometry. Let me explain this a little bit more and also touch on this question of whether the horizon is painless for an infalling observer. So here's our original black hole picture. And we imagine, say, throwing in a bit of information. And really, we have in mind that the center of the black hole is regular in the full quantum theory. And then the information needs to transfer out. Let's suppose it transfers into modes that are, well, modes when they are very short wavelength and compressed near the horizon. In that case, an infalling observer would see excitation of hard particles falling in, and enough of those particles, in fact, would destroy the horizon itself through gravitational back reaction. But on the other hand, if the information transfers into modes when they are much longer wavelength, say of order the size of the black hole, or a tenth, or a thousandth, then what does the observer falling in see? Well, they see of order one extra quantum of energy, of order of size, 1 over r, 1 over the radius of the black hole, per time r. That's all you really need. So that's like one graviton with the wavelength of this room, crossing this room, per light crossing time of this room, and there's no way you're going to measure that. That's very innocuous. So that's the basic picture. And of course, I have in mind that the space-time picture is not quite the precise picture. The geometry is not strictly the correct picture of the physics, and space-time is only an approximation. So this is sort of a cartoon of what I've modeled in terms of this quantum evolution. Let me mention that this is not necessarily acausal. You might worry about that because it involves information transfer outside the light cone. But the black hole chooses a frame, and so you can't turn that into, at least I don't think, into paradoxes. A couple of further comments. First of all, this statement or expectation that we might want a pain-free horizon restricts the dimension or the effective dimension of the atmosphere Hilbert space. Well, or at least the part of it that gets excited. And that's an important constraint on the evolution. Also, there is a notion of what I'll call weak complementarity. Namely, if you throw a bit of information in and ultimately it transfers out, well, by the time it transfers out, you better not include that bit of information in your internal Hilbert space. That would violate the no cloning principle of quantum mechanics. So there's a sense in which that bit of information at some point needs to get erased, but only after this nice slice description might no longer be any good. Okay, so on information transfer, and in particular in the black hole context, we can explore various other restrictions, both from physical notions, like what I've explained, and from quantum information theoretic constraints. And we've done a little bit more of that in a recent paper, and there's some work in progress. Let me, for example, explain the simplest kind of information transfer that you can imagine. I've already actually given a version of that in these models. But what is the most efficient way of transferring information? Well, if we have two Hilbert spaces, and one of them is a product space, we can simply move a factor from one Hilbert space to the other. It doesn't take much imagination to call that subspace transfer. And you can consider such a transformation modulo unitaries acting on the individual Hilbert spaces either before or after the transformation. And we can, in fact, characterize this kind of minimal information transfer in terms of saturation of a subadditivity condition, which I don't have time to explain here. But that gives one useful way of sort of measuring whether you've got this minimal subspace transfer. Let me give you a contrasting kind of evolution, a very simple toy model of it, and that's of this form. Suppose this is a kind of transformation that would allow you to tell things about what's going on inside the black hole. For example, this kind of evolution, if zero represented dead cat and one represented a live cat, might allow you to measure whether the cat inside black hole is dead or alive, but it doesn't truly transfer the quantum information because you still have information encoded in the inside state. So this is a this is something that doesn't saturate this subadditivity bounds. It's not this minimal kind of information transfer. So going back to the examples I gave, the example I gave, which was most Hawking-like, was minimal. The example with extra flux was not. And you might expect you could be somewhere in between. But there are, I think, possible reasons to expect that the information transfer really is near minimal, because we would like to describe a sort of weak modification of local quantum field theory, a small modification. And also, if black holes really behave thermodynamically, I think that's another hint that we have something like minimal transfer. Finally, there's constraint of a small Hilbert space of the atmosphere states. Okay, well, let me just finish by suggesting how this might fit into a broader picture of physics. The first notion is that quantum states are more basic than space-time. Now, of course, we have a very good approximate notion of locality in physics, so where would that come from, given this statement? And one possibility is exactly this kind of tensor product structure that I've described, that you get approximate localization by having your bigger Hilbert space have an additional structure of tensor factors, and you can have, so to speak, disjoint tensor factors, and those you might think of as corresponding to different spatial regions. And in fact, let's compare how locality gets encoded in local quantum field theory. So the usual statement of commutativity of observables outside the light cone really tells you that those observables create independent tensor factors if they act over here or over here. So that's how we might get at localization, and one might try to build up some quantum analog of a manifold with such a structure. More generally, you can have overlapping tensor factors and common factors and so on, and some patching transformations, basically, that give you something like a manifold. Here, there are common ideas both with the algebraic description of quantum field theory. Also, Banks has said some similar things, though there are really some important differences there, because Banks is trying, well, for various reasons. One is that Banks is trying to give a holographic sort of boundary description of space-time, and really I have in mind that this is something like an approximately local description of space-time structure. Of course, if we're talking about evolution, we need to understand unitary evolution, which is approximately local with respect to this structure, and reproduces in the relevant limit local quantum field theory. And then you can ask questions about things like symmetries. For example, symmetries in quantum mechanics or quantum field theory are implemented by unitary transformations, and a global symmetry corresponds to a unitary transformation acting on the whole Hilbert space. And with this kind of structure, you can also have an analog of a local transformation by acting differently on different non-overlapping factors. So this is a suggestion for the kind of structure we need, a sort of, what I call a Hilbert space network, and that kind of structure could provide a framework for a unitary theory of quantum gravity. So just to conclude, it seems to me that the information problem is foundational. Maybe we've made a stupid mistake. Maybe there are less conservative resolutions of the problem. I'm trying to go after the principles in conflict, go after the principle that seems weakest, which is locality. Maybe there's something completely different that happens. So that's really driving at the second point, and most conservative approach is to think about how local quantum field theory locality could, to put it differently, not be an exact concept. but still, let's try to keep quantum mechanics and Lorentz invariance. And so the notion is that unitarity could be restored through, in the black hole context, quantum information transfer from, say, the black hole subsystem to the exterior subsystem in a fashion that cannot be described by local quantum field theory, but might not be so far from local quantum field theory evolution, at least by some measure. And then finally, I've suggested how this could fit into a broader framework in terms of these this notion of a Hilbert space network. So I'll stop there. Thanks. No.
Oh, but it seems that if this black hole was a very young black hole, then all the information's in there, and then a black hole with corresponding area that just happened to be similar area, but that's very old. That black hole has gotten time to mature, and in fact, it has managed to do a bunch of transfer. So these two situations are different, even though they have different area.
Yeah, so you're not going after quite, or at least I'm giving a different description of the information content. What I mean by that is I have in mind that the dimension of the internal Hilbert space could be given by the exponential of the Bekenstein-Hawking entropy. Now that doesn't mean that, say, if you make a young black hole, let's think about how to make a young black hole. You have a high energy collision of two particles in a pure state. Okay? You make such a young black hole, you may be creating a specific state in that Hilbert. Just like a collision of, say, two high-energy photons in this room. There's a big Hilbert space in this room, but we're looking at a particular state. And so by that measure, no, we're not populating the whole Hilbert space. But the idea is that there is an internal Hilbert space there. It's finite dimensional, and plausible conjecture is that the dimension is given by the exponential of the Bekenstein-Hawking entropy. And then as you evolve in time, as it becomes older, say if I make one, like I've just described, what happens is the internal states entangle with the outgoing Hawking radiation, and ultimately you build up an entanglement entropy between the outgoing Hawking radiation and the internal states, which is of order, the entanglement entropy is of order the Bekenstein-Hawking entropy. But then, as the black hole Hilbert space starts to shrink, as the thing really starts getting a lot smaller than, say, half of its original size, then you really do have to start squeezing the information back out. And at this point, that's information. Well, at this point, those internal states are entangled with the previous outgoing Hawking radiation, and that information has to start coming out. So I think it's all perfectly consistent with the notion that the Bekenstein-Hawking entropy means something important. So first of all, it seems that whatever answers the question, I think there's a good argument that it needs to be non-perturbative in gravity. Now the kinds of processes you're describing are, I think, non-perturbative. But a potential flaw there is they give sort of corrections to amplitudes that are tiny, of order e to the minus s. And you might say, well, that looks like the right size. Let me give you a measure for that. If you have the Hawking density matrix that I exhibited, how much do we have to change the individual matrix elements in order to have a pure state? And the answer is this typical size, e to the minus s, okay? But that's in a generic basis. What we need to have a pure state density matrix is a very carefully coordinated change of each of the elements by a number of order e to the minus s. And that's actually an order one change in another basis. And so there's no indication, there are various other objections that have been raised, but to my mind, there's no indication that some generic e to the minus s effect will be the right kind of coordinated effect between all of the elements, e to the s elements of the density matrix, to add up to the right kind of order one effect, if you say it in the right way. And the order one effect, you know, where's order one? Well, order one is the deviation between the two curves I had, the von Neumann entropy if you have unitary evolution versus not. I don't see how to get that from the generic effect of order e to the minus s. You don't. What's that? Well, that's a really big conspiracy. Where does it come from?
Yeah. I was wondering if, I mean, this is all based on the evolution of qubits and things, so you need non-extremality. Is there something one can probe on extremal black holes to see how the picture changes on zero?
First of all, so it's not based on qubits. I'm really just using the qubit models to boil it down to, you know, simple toy models.
Yeah.
And really, I described in, you know, a paper I wrote a few months back, you know, how to think about these finite dimensional Hilbert spaces more generally and this information transfer more generally. Now, with regard to near extremal black holes, yeah, I think one has a similar story there.
Even extremal. I mean, when we look at supersymmetric black holes.
Extremal is not. Let's think about physics. I've never seen an extremal black hole. There's. What's that?
Have you seen a non-extremal?
Our friends have, I believe. There's one at the center of the galaxy. What's that? Near is a different story, but actually extremal, you know, that's kind of a funny limit. Yeah, well, okay, there have been lots of debates and discussion about this, but the basic notion that I have in my mind, and you know, there was a lot of discussion at the Santa Barbara workshop, is the fuzzball picture is proposing that you have a lot of information encoded in states outside the horizon. There's no true horizon. There's you know, a lot of information encoded in these quantum states, which involve some rapidly varying microstructure, say, to encode all of that information. Now, the big question then is, if I hit that with a particle or with my atoms, why don't they scatter? And if they do scatter, then I'm not going to like that very well. That's going to be pretty painful if I hit the surface of a fuzzball and my atoms scatter. Samir refers to this as the infall problem. He has ideas for how it's solved, but you know, really, I think it's a serious problem, and we haven't seen concretely how you would solve it and have something like, what I think many of our expectations are, that if you fall across the horizon of either the black hole at the center of the galaxy or what McClure would call the fuzzball at the center of the galaxy, so if you fall across that, I think many of us would expect that you survive for a while after crossing the horizon. Okay, you can sail through the horizon, you're in trouble later. Maybe that's not right, but it's a bigger departure from local quantum field theory, I think, than the kind of thing I'm